We're TTB, the Alcohol and Tobacco Tax and Trade Bureau.
So hello, everybody. Welcome to part four of our boot camp webinar series. I'm Jennifer Hill, even though the screen does say Janelle Christian. I'm the Outreach Program Manager here at TTB. I'm so happy that you all were able to join us today. If you were unable to join the first three sessions of the boot camp, you can find those presentations on our website at ttb.gov. And if you select the Get Training on the right-hand navigation and then TTB Presentations on the next page, you'll be able to find those. So in our first session, we provided an overview of TTB and the permitting process. Session two, we covered records, reports, and returns. And then in session three, formulas. The presentation for today's session can also be found on that same presentations page, and it should already be up there for you all. Recordings of each of these sessions will be posted eventually on that same Get Training page. We're currently working through the transcribing process and getting those through our internal approvals, so hope to have those up and ready soon. Our next session of the bootcamp series will be Thursday, November 17th from 2 to 3 p.m. Eastern time, so same thing, Thursdays 2 to 3. And in that one, we will cover what to expect in a plant product integrity investigation, including some useful compliance tips. So make sure that you register for that one. And you can register for that one using the outreach page on ttb.gov by selecting outreach under the What We Do menu on the homepage. A few more virtual housekeeping items, and then I will turn things over to Ian Buchanan to begin today's session. We will be answering questions today using the Zoom Q&A functionality. So at the bottom of your Zoom screen, you should see a little box that says Q&A. So as questions arise, we encourage you to post those in the Q&A box as we have the chat functionality disabled for all the participants. Stephanie Fields from our Alcohol Labeling and Formulation Division, or ALFD, will be behind the scenes monitoring that Q&A box during Ian's presentation and answering questions as they arrive. Then as she answers those questions, they'll actually be posted in the answer section of that Q&A, so you'll be able to see those in live time. And then at the end, Ian will still be available to answer any lingering or last minute questions that may arise. Also at the end of the presentation today, there will be a QR code for our survey. We strongly encourage everyone to complete this very quick survey. We do truly use the responses to understand the needs of our industry members for future outreach activities and see where we can make improvements. So without further ado, I'm going to introduce our speaker for today, Ian Buchanan. Ian is a labeling specialist in the Distilled Spirits Labeling Office within ALFD. Ian began working at TTB in 2020 and serves as an expert in distilled spirit labeling. He provides guidance to customers on labeling concerns, the intersection of formulation and labeling, and the COLA and COLA exemption approval process, all of which he will be covering today. He received his Master's of Public Administration from American University. He and his wife are the proud parents of two cats who you may get a chance to meet during today's presentation. And fun fact, he is a classically trained baritone singer. So you all are in very talented hands today. So before I turn things over, we do like to get a little interaction from the crowd, even though we can't see your faces or hear your voices. So we do that using a few poll questions. So I'm going to launch one poll question here, and then there'll be a second one. So the first one is, we just want to understand your experience with TTB, specifically labeling. So how many labels have you submitted to TTB? And your options are 0, 1 to 10, 10 to 20, 20 plus. So it looks like people are answering. I'll give people a few seconds here so we can maybe capture everybody and then I can share the results. All right, I'm gonna end the poll and then I'm gonna share the results. So it looks like we have a pretty even spread of the crowd. So 30% have never submitted a label, and then we have 40% who have submitted 20 or more. So good news is that Ian has information that will help all of you. So that is going to be great. Okay, second poll question. This is a little bit of a pop quiz. So how many mandatory pieces of information are required on a label? 3, 4, 5, or 6 or more? We'll give everybody about 30 seconds here. It's always fun to do a little pop quiz. Back to our school days. I'm going to end the poll. All right. So looks like we had a little bit of a spread. We had people say four, some say five. A lot of people said six or more. Ian, I won't take away the surprise for you to give the answer to this question.
Better say, have fun. You'll get the full deal here, but the answer is six or more, if not more information, depending upon what kind of product you got and if you are importing from a different country.
So with that, I am going to hand you all over to Ian, and I will begin sharing the presentation.
Perfect. So hi, everyone. Like we said earlier, my name is Ian Buchanan. I'm a labeling specialist here with TTB, and I will be taking you through the process here of our webinar series. And you'll see in the next slide, you'll have a fun depiction of a still and where we fit into the process in labeling. First, I want to say that we provide these for educational purposes, but what you need to do if you ever have a specific question or if you're ever in doubt about something, you always need to cite the regulations. We are providing this as an educational experience to you, but if I ever make a mistake on this, make sure you cite the reg beforehand in order to make sure there's no sort of difficulty, inconvenience, or error on our part. Always cite 27 CFR Part 5. It is your best friend and mine too. So when it comes to labeling, we're in the fourth part of the process. So you've had to go through the song and dance with us before too. We come from permitting to make sure your DSP is in order, after which you start production to making your formulated product and dealing with formulation if necessary. Then you'll produce, distill your spirits. And then before you bottle, you come to us to make sure that your label is going to be in order. And you never want to bottle before this point, because you can run into issues or errors with production, even something as small as spelling issues, missing a government warning, something like that, which causes us to have to stop your approval, notice things that may, where there may be errors or have other issues, which will turn into us having to reach out to say, hey, we caught this problem. So save yourself time, error, issues. Make sure you do not bottle until you get your label approved. Then you bottle and remove, file taxes, report changes necessary, and then go through the circular process as it's shown here. And next for us will be our six, seven or more pieces of mandatory labeling information that I alluded to earlier. So we no longer have an air quotes, brand name, ever since we updated our regulations earlier in March. What we have now are three pieces of information that have to appear in the same field of vision. That's our fun jargony way of saying they all have to appear on the same side of the container and all can be read without you having to turn the bottle, can, or whatever else you may be using. And those pieces are the brand name, your class and type, and the alcohol content. In addition to that, anywhere else on the bottle, you'll have your bottler's or importer's name with address, your net content statement, the size, the health warning statement, and the country of origin if you're importing. In addition to that, we have another list afterwards of different circumstantial things that may come up depending upon your type of product or specific ingredients being used. Among these are a sulfide declaration, your coloring, your flavoring material, which I'll go into more detail about how that information has to be displayed. FD&CL number 5 is a special version of this where you have to call this one out by name, and that is in regs. And I can't give you the exact site, but it'll tell you if it because it is an allergen or cause something like that too, you have to say, contains FD&CL number 5. Cochineal extract, carmine, act like FD&CL number 5, along with treatment of wood. For your neutral spirits, your vodkas and gins, you'll have a percentage of neutral spirits, or if you have any sort of blended whiskeys, brandies, any sort of product like that, same sort of deal. That ties into your commodity statement, same sort of thing. You're distilled from grain or other base commodity, sugar cane and the like. Statements of age for some specific products in format of aged X years or X years old, and then the state of distillation for a suite of whiskeys as well too. Okay, so our brand name. So this is the name under which the product is sold. You want it usually, what we like to see or what is common practice is this is going to be that big, bold, eye-catching text that you're going to sell your product based upon, usually centered, much different from the rest of it, something that is going to really draw the consumer's eyes to whatever this product is going to be. However, you do not want to use a brand name that is going to mislead the consumer as to what is in the bottle. And we are particularly aware of that when it comes to mezcals and tequilas. And there can be issues because of how those products are regulated to Mexico and how we respect those definitions with the Mexican government too. So no making of anything with a quila or a scal at the end of it while trying to dance around that with a pun-like name. If it's made in the States or anywhere outside of Mexico, it's an agave spirit and it can't be referred to as such. Same thing if you're ever going to make, say, a whiskey from a mash that isn't a grain, but you're making a whiskey-like product, you're going to age it in oak afterwards too. You can't use a pun to describe that. You don't want it to be a brand or a fanciful name, different sort of thing, same sort of arena. Avoid those sort of puns and you should be all right. And we'll have a great example of that in our next slide, which is going to be a fun representation of a spiced rum product, which helps us a lot here too. Notice in the circle, we have Cap'n John's. That's what I would expect to be the brand name for this product. And we have spiced rum beneath it. That is a fanciful name, which works in tandem with the statement of composition that you see below for a distilled spirit specialty. And that's another mandatory piece only for the DSS products. And that includes cocktails as well. So it all comes together. You can see the word spiced rum in the same sort of font style too. So you're not trying to hide or confuse the consumer about what it is or what isn't supposed to be. It's a spiced rum, not a traditional rum, according to our regs. And these work in tandem to show that this is, you know, a distilled spirit specialty product. All right, classes and types. Many different definitions for you available in 27 CFR 5141. I want to make a special note here about saying that if your product has to meet the very specific language being put into all of these regs. And when I speak to this, the example that always jumps out is going to be bourbon whiskey underneath this class and type under 27 CFR 5143C2. If your product is not made of at least 51% corn mash and it was not aged in charred new oak, then you do not have a bourbon whiskey according to these regs. You'll see that minutia for every one of these products, which can lead to some confusion too. For a more generic example, I've seen certain products where an individual is distilling a spirit from sorghum and was claiming that it was a rum. That is not the case. Rums must be distilled from sugarcane or sugarcane byproducts. So when we get into issues like that too, it turns into, it's a reflection of our regs and the specific standard of identity for the product. So you got to make sure you follow along with these. Most of them are pretty straightforward of information that you know or have dealt with in the past. I would say just be aware of dealing with imitations, geographical designations, same thing for tequila, mezcal. Those are products of Mexico alone. In the same way, a Scotch whiskey can only be made distilled in Scotland. It cannot be made outside of it. So any language that would refer to a product as a Scotch, ensure you have qualifying language around it saying it was made in the USA in a Scotch-like style, not that it is Scotch whiskey alone. And distilled spirit specialty will go, but I will give you the minutiae of that when we get to it too. And after that, we have the definition for a distilled spirit specialty here, which is found in 27 CFR 5156, where you're going to have a formulated product that doesn't have a commonly understood definition. That's going to be the catch-all we have for DSS, distilled spirit specialty products. And with that, you're going to provide a fanciful name and a statement of composition, which is going to tell the consumer what is going to actually be in the can or the bottle. And that's going to have a specific layout shown below. So margarita made with tequila, triple sec liqueur, and FD&C yellow number 5. It's a little bit different for cocktails now in comparison to this. If you were to display margarita and the two base spirits below it, margarita made with a tequila and triple sec liqueur, and elsewhere on the label, separate apart from their text, that way it's easy to find, contains FD&C yellow number 5, that would be acceptable as well. Whenever we come to products like this, I would just always advise, make sure you reference your formula, make sure you are following instructions in your results tab. It's going to give you a provisional or what our formulation specialist showed what good generic language for a statement of composition should be. You can use that, or if you want to put your own spin on it, just make sure you're referring to specific ingredients that I can cross-reference in your formula and you should be good to go. To that. So here's the class type that's going to come afterwards here. You see spiced rum and rum with natural flavors added together. The fanciful name differentiates this product from other, you know, normal rums, and you have your SSC below it, statement of composition, your rum with natural flavors added. Alcohol content. So here, straightforward again, what the alcohol content of your product is going to be too. You have your variations on this where you have your percent alcohol. You can spell it out or choose to use ALC period slash BOL period too. Bottled at is reserved for products that have some solids in the bottle along with two. So if you are adding gold flake or the titanium dioxide to make that sort of shimmering effect that replicates a gold flake or something like that too, you probably have a formulated product, and that's going to require formula approval. It would be a vodka with an artificial color or a vodka with gold flake, and you'll use bottled at X percent alcohol as opposed to alcohol alone. Different point here too, your proof, it is an optional statement. That's gonna have to just be the double amount of your alcohol content, but it does not ever stand in for it alone. So you couldn't just have 80 proof in place of alcohol by volume. You have to show 40 alcohol and 80 proof together. And that can appear anywhere on the label. And your tolerance here too, I forget the exact citation, but you have a 0.3% tolerance in what your alcohol content will be measured at, as opposed to what is claimed on the bottle. So just be careful about what's going in there too. It's something that can be found if you are going to be in an investigation. So make sure that you're within that 0.3% as shown in the regs, and you'll be fine and be touted as a normal vodka or whatever other product too. Next, we have our alcohol content in the correct format below with an additional proof statement at the bottom. And notice that everything on that left side of that one label, brand name, fanciful name, statement of composition, two together, fanciful name and statement of composition, work here's your class type, and alcohol content all in the same field of view. I see everything without having to turn or kind of strain to see where it's going to be on the bottle. And next, we have our bottlers and import information. So this will be referenced based upon the information in your application and the name address section that pops up for you too. We want to see a statement like bottled by, your company name or your trade name DBA that shows up in there in the city and state in which the permit is registered. We'll understand if you are doing contract bottling or you're for someone else too. For our benefit, it's easiest to always add a note to specialist to say we're contract bottling for a company to see this difference. Usually we can understand it if you have the DBA of the company that you're bottling for in the same sort of statement too. Or if you have a specific arrangement where you have to give permission to the contract bottler to use a formula, make sure that a PDF of that document is uploaded and COLA's online to make sure we know what you're doing and that we can assume that you have the permission of the COLA holder to use formulas and all that fun stuff too. Notice there are specific language here being highlighted, bottled by, distilled by, produced by, all have different meanings too. So if you're a contract bottler, you want to avoid, there's my cat. Oof. If you are contract bottling, you want to make sure you stick to bottled by. Produced and distilled by are reserved only for the folks who are actually doing the producing and distilling of the product. For our imported goods, imported by, company name, city, state, you can use sole, US agent, two, and then the colon, company name, deal two, and this information can appear anywhere on the label. From here, so you'll see that this spiced rum was imported with the importer of record XYZ company, city, state, Pittsburgh, PA. Zip code is optional information too. You can add it, you cannot, you don't have to have it, just make sure it aligns with the information on the name address section, or we know that it is supposed to be for a contract bottler or a place of business that's underneath your COLA too. Yeah, net content statement. So we're dealing with the container sizes, and I know we have a different list here of all the different spots. I'm trying to recall at the top of my head and I should be able to do it. So all we're dealing with what the container size, the alcohol product is going to be sold in, and that's going to be 50 milliliter, 100, 200, 355 metal only. And all these can be cans only as well. 375, 700, 720, 750, 900, 1 liter, 1.75 liter, and 1.8. any distilled spirit has to be filled in one of those set sizes. Otherwise, it's not permitted to be sold in the States. So if you are dealing with a European company and importing for them, 500 ml is not going to cut it. It has to be in one of our standards of fill. And I think the list should be on the next slide for us. Here we are. I think I checked my language here. So containers open, cans, bottles, anything else like that, have your sizes that you're permitted to use. And after that should be the cans, which have a specific definition too. General shape and design of can with the closure as an integral part of the container, which cannot be readily reclosed after opening. So hot top can opening up like a beer can or a pop can, same sort of deal. And that's what we understand to be a can. You have 355 milliliter, 12 ounce, 200 ml, 100 ml and 50 ml. And you'll see it's displayed here, separate apart from all of our text on the right label. Next for us, the fun portion, the government warning statement is something I see a great deal of mistakes of too. Though it doesn't have to be shown in the same exact format, sticking to something like this, once you have a good template, is something that I would always recommend, because you have to make sure that these very specific grammatical rules are followed. We'll have a slide after this too, but I want to use the visual of having it right in front of us to show the unacceptable format. So you see government warning being in all caps, and that language and the colon after it is in all bold. You have a one in parentheses marks and a two surrounded by parentheses marks. Not a period afterwards or inside of it, not with brackets or not just starting with the sentence afterwards too. Two parentheses marks surrounding the two numbers. You have a comma after general, a period at the end of the first sentence after defects, and then a comma after machinery, and then a period at the end of the second sentence after problems. And I think we should see that same sort of layout in the next slide too. Yep. I forgot to add to with the third and fourth, and the last lines here too. If you choose not to show everything in all caps, you have to ensure that the S and surgeon and the G in general are capitalized. This is supposed to be one continuous statement too, so no intervening text. Don't put anything in between it, like your bottlers or importer statement in between this information. You got to make sure it shows in one block. It has to be legible in a contrasting background. So black, white, easy for me to read and review and understand. If it isn't legible, I have to send it back, because this is essentially every information that has to be easily read and separate and apart. So with the space in between everything and above it, that way it stands separate and apart from all other text. And next should be the depiction at the bottom. So government warning, everything is in all caps, but this is also all bold with colon afterwards. And then the information is shown in the correct way, comma after general, period after defects, comma after machinery, period after health problems, and the language reads off appropriately. All right, so for imported goods, you have to display an importer statement showing where the product's country of origin is. And we defer to US Customs and Border Protection requirements here, which say you have to use product of company, or you show, you know, produced in nation, excuse me, instead. And we'll see on the next one, it'll show the country of origin statement in English. And I should say this too, this information has to be displayed in English. So unless you are in Canada, which can use the French product of Canada, or Mexico, made in Mexico, HO in Mexico. Those are the only two which can use, you know, native language as French or Spanish, as opposed to the English statement product of the Dominican Republic. All right, so coloring materials. These are detailed in our regs, and the new fields and menus under 27 CFR 572, which will reference the information below it. So going into 27 CFR 5141, the standards of identity, they'll tell you which products can have coloring or flavoring materials too. And I would always say you can reference our guidance. I believe it's TTB guidance 2016-3 to speak about what products may have formulas tied to it and what information you should look before you add anything to it. But in most instances, if you're going to add a bunch of color that's going to fundamentally change how it looks, it's going to be a formulated product. It's going to be a vodka with artificial color, gin with artificial color, whatever it may be. And you'll have a different sort of definition if you have a liqueur or a distilled spirit or a cocktail where you can show a separate color statement and it shows the information over here too. So you have your three examples, you're colored with caramel, certified color added. So that's reserved for your FD&C blues and reds and yellow six, not yellow five. That's different. And you have artificially colored as well, which covers everything. Note that there is not a natural color on here. Separate information, anything you do to change the hue of a product is going to consider to be artificially coloring it, which leads us to have to use a specific language. So if you want to avoid, you know, artificially is a scary word, I understand that. You can always stick to the color's name. So colored with caramel, colored with annatto, or, you know, annatto color added would be acceptable too. So we have our special ones here that have to be called up by name. So like I said earlier, FD&C yellow number five is an allergen. So you have to call it its use by name. So it contains FD&C yellow number five or colored with FD&C yellow number five. Cochineal extract and carmine color act in the same way too and have to be touted by name. So follow the same sort of method here. If you're going to use the if and or contains or artificially, so you call them out by name to say, you know, contains cochineal extract or colored with cochineal extract. Commodity statements for our neutral spirits. In here, where we're going to be dealing with your gins and vodka and grain neutral spirits, cane neutral spirits, and the like too, you're going to have your two different definitions of how these statements are supposed to be made. So if your product follows the method of manufacture at the top, you'll use your percentages. This, you know, will include your blends too, if you have your blended whiskey with neutral spirits of some sort, where you can show how much of the product is made of neutral spirits. So X neutral spirits distilled from Y, the commodity name, and then percentage of neutral spirits too, so 80, 90, whatever it may end up being. And from gin distilled from a process to continuous distillation, you'll have distilled from grain, distilled from cane, whatever your base commodity was. Statements of age. So here is the list of the products that is going to require you to have an age statement too. So many whiskey aged for less than 4 years, you have to have a separate age statement on there. If it's not on there, we assume you have aged at 4 years and we'll take you at your word, but note that the regs do say that you have to have your age statement if it is not aged for 4 years. Certain brandy is not stored in oak barrels for a period of 2 years. This is especially important for great brandies because it changes the class type. If it is not 2 years old, you have to use the term immature brandy together, same style, text and font. And provide an age statement. So immature brandy, 12 months, 23 months, whatever it is on the label set. So distilled spirits labels with a distillation date. So if you choose to put your distillation date, so distilled in 2017 for us right now, you'll have to have a separate storage statement saying stored in oak barrels for 5 years, or you'll have two statements showing 5 years old and you'll show the type of cooperage used to make sure that we know that your product is meeting the correct distillation date and we know when it was both distilled and aged and then bottled. And then it's allowed on every single type of spirit now too. That's a change from the regs that happened not super recently, but in the, you know, near past, and the only information where this can't be displayed is for neutral spirits and vodkas, all that stuff. Organic. Organic has special rules, and this is something where I'm always going to advise folks to review the information we have available to you first and calling in to us if you ever have questions. That way we can advise you on what information that needs to be seen, because there are four different varieties of organic claims. You have your 100% or other percent organic, you have a made with statement, you have a different layer too, where a majority are going to ask you, so you have made with organic ingredient, then you have the ingredient statement too. The majority are going to require an ACA preview showing all labels with the stamp of the approving official. The only instance where that is not the case is when you're dealing with an organic ingredient statement. So you're making something with an ingredient statement showing ingredients, colon, water or wheat, organic honey, whatever it may be, that ingredient statement still requires an op sheet to be uploaded to the showing that it was made in organic fashion to the attachment section of your COLA. And if you ever have questions about this, if you are concerned about language being used, because I see a lot of folks slipping in an organic claim in descriptive text elsewhere on the label, and that triggers the need to have an ACA preview. So run stuff by us first. We can always talk this out with you, but I want you to use the links provided here and to look up the organic examples that we have online as well. Additional information. So this is going to cover everything else that comes along with our label. We don't mind you touting descriptive text, having anything you use to differentiate yourself from other products, but it has to be truthful, accurate, specific. It cannot conflict or qualify with mandatory label information and comply with corresponding sections of our regs. And that turns into something else because we have a whole bunch of prohibited practices which may cause an issue or an error, like any depiction or the use of the word pure to describe a distilled spirit is not permitted. If you are going to make anything that can resemble or be understood as a health claim, even as something where I can understand that text saying that the consumption of this distilled spirit is going to lead to some sort of physical or mental outcome, that's considered a health claim and cannot appear. So if you tell me that consuming this vodka will cause my lips to tingle, that's a health claim. That's something that can appear on there too. Most stuff is straightforward too. I always say tout and speak to the quality of your product, because disparaging other folks, comparing, making other comparisons to your competition is not permitted. Talk about the quality and how your product stands out. All right, so we're talking about our jargon now, about what a COLA is. It is a certificate of label approval. It is the document that you're going through to make sure that your label meets our regulations, and it is required for anyone to sell in interstate commerce, that meaning going across state lines, to work through here too. And we'll talk about the exemption, which is about internal state commerce as well too. And it details who has to get a COLA, basically everyone, if you're going to sell this product or import into the US. So here, that breakdown again for when you have to apply for COLA approval. So prior to bottling, canning the spirit. So things are finished waiting for you in the tank and waiting to be bottled. That's when you come to us to get your COLA approval to make sure everything is okay there. And then you start the bottling process afterwards. And for imported goods, you have to get it prior to removal from customs duty. So COLA is being required. So it's going to be required if that product will be sold or introduced into interstate commerce. So if it's only being sold within state, but you plan to go interstate afterwards too, you have to come through us to get the COLA approved, or it has to be imported in bottles. So, and this is where we also deal with the exemption process too. So we have the certificate of exemption from label approval, which is still you filling out the same COLA form and getting it approved through TTB, but you're going to select a different box during your application process where you'll show that is going to be for intrastate commerce, and you'll add an additional piece of label information showing for sale in name of state, bottled only. So for sale in Kentucky, California, whatever it may be, you'll have to have that separate statement on your label set too. And next, how do we go through the COLA approval process? Your other best friend here with us, COLA's Online. And I'm always going to say this is the easiest way for you to go through the COLA approval process. We do still allow paper applications, but COLA's Online allows us to get through things much quicker. It also allows us to go through a corrections process, which is gonna provide you much more information rather than us having to go through reject and send a paper application back to you as well. It also gives the opportunity for you to reach out to us through our TIC line, our Technical Information Center, and speak with us about how the process is going in case you need any sort of status update. And we want to make sure that we provide this info to you. So call into us or into our other help with the registration or the COLA's Online team, and we'd be happy to assist you if you ever run into COLA's Online issues. So here, other tips to make sure you know when you can get your COLA done quickly, which kind of aligns with the certain errors we see a lot of. Know when your product needs a formula and how to read that formula and how that impacts your label too. I will always say, We have online tools to make sure which beverage, alcoholic beverage or distilled spirit needs a formula. We have an online click-through sheet where you go in, you'll say if you're domestic or importing, and then the type of product afterwards too. You click and it'll give you the result. You can always reference that document I referred to earlier to TTBG 2016-3, which gives that same information, but just in a spreadsheet format. So you can control F your type of product and then look to see if it needs a formula, if domestic or imported as well. So here, brand name and fanciful name. We have some leeway here and we'll speak to the conditional approval process too. But when it comes to brand and fanciful names, I want to see prominent text, which stands apart from other things, which will be eye-catching and easy for us to read and also appear in the same field of vision as your class type designation and your alcohol content. If it isn't there, and sometimes it isn't, you can play with it and we can try to designate other text or use a default if necessary, in your, which is the company name in your bottler statement. So here for the brand name stuff, don't follow along and put your actual brand name in there too. Note that we cannot allow class type designations on their own to be brand or fanciful names. So no putting rum or vodka or gin or whiskey or bourbon whiskey in either of those fields. Those are not permitted. You have to use other text. And then this usually deals with some certain technical limitations we have to deal with Kohl's Online. I know it is annoying that we have that fidelity, the size of JPEG limit too, but make sure you can read the information in Kohl's Online too, because I cannot read all text on there. I can't approve the label and I have to kick it back to you too. And this can be stuff as minor as text that appears in the seals of awards that you're putting onto the label afterwards. If I can't read that tiny text in there, I can't assume that you're calling the thing the right way. And I'll give an example that I dealt with recently where a company was importing a vodka distilled spirit specialty from Europe. And on that, it showed award languages that showed best vodka as opposed to vodka with XYZ color, whatever it was too. That language had to be removed because it was a class type error, because it touted the product as a vodka when it was not. So anything small like that, anything that we can read or see, any text, we have to be able to review and make sure it doesn't conflict with your mandatory label info. So give it a good read over, make sure your images aren't corrupted or too small or blurry to read, and you'll be good. I spoke to this earlier too about the conditional approved status, where we have a little bit of leeway to work with some information in Kohl's Online to make sure that we can get an approval the first go around if every other, you know, piece of information is right, or if we have to qualify stuff to make sure we get this out to you the first time. Basically, we will make changes to your electronic application that will show up when it's kicked back to you, and you'll see a new status of conditionally approved. And if you accept it, it'll go through on the first time without you having to send it back to us, basically just changing a brand name or a fanciful name. And it should show up on the next slide, speaking of the process. So here, and I know if we provide you with a name that you don't want to tout with, or there's some sort of language you have to work with your distributor to make sure that information is exactly as it is, we understand if it has to go back, but you have to go in and decline, or Kohl's Online will automatically decline it if it hasn't changed within 5 or 7 days. Don't quote me on the exact one there, but after a week, it'll be automatically sent back to us. And the two fields involved, like I said, are the brand name and the fanciful name. So say you have a distilled spirit specialty or a cocktail and you forgot to type in the name of the cocktail or your fanciful name, we can do that on our end. We'll choose provisional language that shows up on your label. And if you accept that change, it'll be approved the first time. Okay, our allowable revisions, and we'll have some fun examples of that information after this too. There is a specific list of, I believe, 33 allowable revisions where you can make changes to your label without having to come through us. And usually with an additional caveat, after this has already been approved in Kohl's Online. So if you have already gotten approval previously and you want to change displays of information, if you want to remove things, if you just want to deal with how specific text is being displayed, that's usually going to be okay. But if you're dealing with the addition of text, new graphics, anything that could fundamentally change how we understand the product or would affect any mandatory label info, then you have to come back through us for approval. So here we should have some questions. So notice here, the first one, This is deletion of any non-mandatory labeled text. So what has happened is just the removal of the ribbon and the palm trees shown above, but Captain John's, spice rum, with natural flavors, alcohol proof, and net content all remained the same. Nothing has changed the class type designation of the product. You got your fanciful name and SOC there. This is acceptable. Here, so this is the repositioning of any text. Notice that we still have all the front label stuff in the same view. So vodka, alcohol content, net content. We still have Sunnyside Distillery in Springfield, Oregon, which is additional information. Nothing changed. Nothing was altered to the class type. Nothing would mislead the consumer about what this product is. This is good. Here, so this is changing the color of background and text and making alterations that don't fundamentally change the information. It's also a good time for me to point out too how we have a little bit of leeway and how we want to see brand names displayed too. So for me, when I see Chimes Distillery, you have that bold and outline text where they are shown in the same style, though they're not immediately just, you know, Chimes Break Distillery. That's acceptable as a brand name, not an issue. We understand what's being done there. But on the right, you still see the same label information is being displayed. There's been no addition of extra text or something else that's going to confuse the consumer or potentially us when we're reviewing. You're still calling everything the same stuff. No alteration, alcohol content. Well, excuse me, that's a different thing. No going below the limit for a rum, and you still have the same net content. Good there. Leads us to a different thing though. You can change your net content without having to go through a COLA approval process. Note here, I went from a fifth handle of 750 ml to 1.75. That's acceptable. And so long as you don't change anything else to the label set, we're good to go there as an allowable revision. And here, this is why I had to hold myself about what was being said earlier. You can change the alcohol content such that it does not change the class and type designation of the product. So if there ever you ever see that limit in the definition of 80 proof, 40% alcohol, you can never dip beneath that, but you can change it to reflect whatever your method of manufacture or your proofing process and what is actually going into the bottle. And you'll see the actual specific language happening in the comment section there too. So abide by that and you'll be good. Same sort of deal for your commodity statements too. If you're using the same ingredients, just changing how much neutral spirit is going into it, you'll change as necessary to fit what you're actually producing. So we have the change from 90% neutral spirit to 80% instead. And here we have the change of a mandatory age statement. In this instance, it was just taken away. And because this product has met that 2-year minimum for a brandy, there is no need to have to show an age statement. It's already understood and known that we have this information here. There's no issue in this state. There's no issue here to change your age statement to accurately reflect what is in the bottle. Here we just have additional information. In this case, you can add, delete, or change bottle deposit information. So if you want to show the recycling worth of the product, you can just add it here after COLA approval. Excuse me, another CAD issue. Without having to go through the COLA approval process. For the next one, we have the addition of UPC barcodes, mobile barcodes, QR codes, Microsoft tags, and this works like links leading to your business or operations or anything like this. You have to abide by the UPC code here too, so don't have this linking to information that would conflict with your class type on here or information that would be misleading about the product. So if everything is okay with your advertising, you're good to add this barcode afterwards as well. And here you have your batch number. You can add this information or change the identification for your serial numbers too. You'll see, usually we commonly see just a section of field where it says batch NO colon. You can add that information afterwards too. And from here, we have the additional trademarks also, what would be, you know, your kosher designation, anything going towards your social media sites too, trademark logos, all that fun stuff that can be added or removed as necessary. So here, As I was speaking about those award seals earlier too, you can add them after they have been provided to you. Just make sure that nothing on that award ribbon or seal is going to conflict with the label provided to Colas online. And here you have leeway with holiday themed labels too, so long as they don't add any sort of conflicting stuff. So if you have a Halloween label, Thanksgiving, Christmas, whatever it may be, you can add this sort of tag information without having to come through us for COLA approval. And like always, just make sure it doesn't conflict with any regs and you'll be set. So stuff that cannot be made with an allowable revision. If you are going to change the class and type, if you're going from a rum to a flavored rum, you have to make sure that you're going to get a formula approved for us. If you're going to proof down below 40%, that's a diluted rum that requires a new COLA too. If you're going to change a brand name entirely, has to come through us, cannot be covered as an allowable revision. If you are adding any of the graphics not specifically authorized by those 33 different allowable revisions, has to come back through COLAs and add or change any wording that isn't specifically authorized to. I will say, if you're ever concerned about this or feel like you don't want to, if you do not want to leave yourself up for the open to the potential of making a mistake, you can submit any sort of change to label to us for COLA approval too. That way, you know that you have the approval of TTB, that every rule has been followed and that no mistakes were made. So you can use allowable revisions as you see fit, but if you want to make sure the ball is in our court, you can always submit another COLA too. And with that, we have our contact information regarding each process here. So we have our phone number for the Technical Information Center for us, so 866-927-2533. Option 2 will get you COLAs online technical assistance. 3 will get online registration. And 4 comes to us for labeling concerns too, about the regs concerning what can and cannot appear on the label information. All the stuff usually tends to work on a continuum. So if you have to deal with COLAs online issues, talk to the folks over on technical assistance or for registration first to make sure you have access to your account. If JPEGs aren't working, if there's corruption issues to your technical assistance folks, and then come to us once you have, you know, the minutia what of the wording of the verbiage or whatever else may be on there too. In any case, we'll get you routed to the right spot. And we always say, oh, we want you to call us. We want you to bring your concerns and questions to us. That way we can assist you, because we know the many regulatory hoops you have to go through. We want to be a go-to resource for you to make sure you get product on shelves as soon as possible. And then we have our online contact form here on the link below too. And with that, we have additional information with our labeling pages, which provide you with additional citation and information for you to look up. We have a labeling homepage and a mandatory checklist and the anatomy tools too. And I think next we're going to be able to see the checklist, which gives you the exhaustive rules for what has to, what should and what should not appear in your label, what mandatory information has to be there, and what additional info can be there as well. All this stuff is, it'll give you the exact information that you need to make sure you're abiding by our rules. And I think with the example after this, let's see what we got. Our checklist, and that's going to give you an unfortunately out of date regulatory citation, which does not reflect the current one. But if you ever have issues, you can always look up in the Electronic Code of Federal Regulations under Title 27, Part 5, that's the distilled spearing stuff, to look up this brand name stuff. You'll get a definition first, probably at the top, and then brand name will have its own site, probably in the 560s, if I remember right, and it'll tell you what a brand name is and then how it should appear and where it needs to appear on the container. After that, this is our anatomy of a distilled spirits label, which is like online interactive version of what I'm doing here, where you can click on the different portions of this label here. It's the same sort of spice drum. So we're trying to cover all bases by giving you a distilled spirit specialty, you know, one of our complex ones, which tells you what a brand name is in this case, where you can see where you have the red box highlighted over brand name. You'll have a text box pop up when you put your cursor over it. You'll be able to see this is what a brand name is. This is required label information. The same thing would be true. You look over spiced rum, it would show up as fanciful name, and then your SOC, rum with natural flavors, if you were to use the tool, and it will give you the breakdown about how this information has to be displayed. And then for us, here is the online survey. We ask you to fill out with the QR code here. We want to be open and available to you. We want to make sure that this sort of presentation is useful for your purposes. And we want to make sure we're tailoring the stuff to make sure we're helping you get this done. We want to be here as a resource to assist, because this is the fun part of the job. This is us assisting you and getting this done to make sure that you're succeeding as a business, as opposed to us having to go through label review all the time. I know this is what I enjoy the most, and I want to be available to you all to assist. So if you ever have a concern, you can call in on the tick line and ask for me by name if you choose, or, you know, all of our specialists are excellent at what they do. Give us an opportunity with the survey to make sure that we are addressing what you need. And after that, I think we should be able to take on additional questions unless they have already been answered.
I think, Ian, that your good friend Stephanie, or your wingman as we've called her, has answered all the questions that were in the box. So we'll hold on for just a few minutes and see. Okay, one just came in. Mm-hmm. Question regarding label revision for a line of flavored vodkas. If I have 8 different flavors under the same approved formula, when I submit for my cola approval, do I need to submit each flavor individually, or is the descriptive wording for the flavor an allowable revision, as they would all be labeled as vodka with natural flavors?
If you're using the different flavors at different times, it sounds like you're making what would be considered different products. So any sort of change in that, the addition or subtraction or changing of different flavors they would create different products, which would have to have their own unique statement of composition, because you would have a different method of manufacture. So you may end up with the same statement of composition, which would be vodka with natural flavors, excuse me there, but you would have a different airport product each time, because you wouldn't have the same sort of method of, you know, manufacture. And we'll see if Stephanie agrees with my answer.
Yeah, I see she's typing an answer out too. So I haven't seen anything else pop up in the questions, but I maybe have a question for you, Ian, and maybe you kind of said this along the way, but what would you tell industry members that are on the call, the number one probably issue you see in a label submission?
It's always going to be formula stuff. So we in formulations are basically tied at the hip about what has to appear on that label. I see a bunch of statements of compositions or class type designations which don't match the information in the results tab. And we always go by what is in determination, under determination, approval provisions and labeling instructions. So it's like the second and third and fourth tabs that take up the bottom portion of that. If that information doesn't align with what I see in the label, I have to kick it back. If in addition to that too, you have the wrong alcohol content or proof statement on the label too, that tends to be an issue. So be careful about the information you input under yield summary, because that reflects the final, what is actually going to be in the bottle, as opposed to what is happening in the middle of production. So sometimes people mix up, they put in proof as opposed to alcohol content. You have a whole bunch of stuff where that can not align. I'll even see stuff where specific ingredients are being touted in a statement of composition that aren't actually in your formula too, and don't have a fid sheet tied to them. So we are bound by the information in that formula. And if you have anything, even like a compound flavor, and you're touting the individual ingredients in that flavor, as opposed to what the name of the flavor is, whether it's like ginger, lime, or whatever, like those two put together on your fit sheet, you have to call that product the XY flavor as opposed to ginger and lime in your product.
And then there was another question that came in. Can a bottle shape dictate a cola approval outside of the label submission?
Bottle shape, not necessarily, though. There will be specific instances where you should put your diagram in the attachment section if there's going to be something like we can't have. It's like if a bottle is opaque and you want to make sure we know what's going to happen in there too, you provide us with an example of it. There are specific companies that will put certain indecent shapes as their bottle container too. And I think you all can imagine what I'm saying here, but you have to go through us to make sure that sort of thing is safe and approvable. So if anything, you know, strange is coming in, if you're making a container in the style of a firearm or something else like that, send an example for us to review to make sure nothing weird's happening for us to get approval on.
Awesome. Thank you. So I will give everybody just a few more minutes to maybe pop in any last minute questions. And of course, you can call in or send an email if you think of any questions post-webinar. Just a reminder that our next webinar on what to expect in an investigation will be November 17th, so 2 weeks from today, 2 to 3 p.m. Eastern time, same time as today. So we hope you all will join us. And again, you can see all these presentations on the TTB website. And hopefully you will see the recorded videos maybe in the next month or so for the sessions that we've already done. So with that, I wanna thank everybody that called in today and joined us for this webinar. We've been really excited with these boot camp webinar sessions. And thank you, Ian, for the presentation today. I think you gave everybody just a lot of information. Oh, there was a question that came in. Can you elaborate on restricted graphic topics like firearms, et cetera?
So perhaps my language was a bit broad there. I was speaking to the actual container being used, not restricted graphics. And there are certain rules for us to follow when something on the bottle can be considered indecent or obscene. I will say we're bound by the First Amendment when it comes to commercial speech. So there is... there are certain protections for you to tout and advertise your product as you see fit. But if you have something which could be concerning, you could always send a note to us if something can be considered obscene or indecent, we have to allow this to go up the chain to be approved or disapproved based upon certain circumstances that are out of my control too. So note that we can provide a lot of approval for a lot of language, which may seem uncouth, but does not rise to that level of obscene or indecent too, because that is a specific legal understanding of the language too. Then when I say containers too, I'm saying specifically for containers that actually look like a firearm. Yes. Like Tracy was saying there too, there is nothing like that specifically too, but I've seen instances before people are making something like a bottle that looks like an actual gun, a firearm itself too. There's no reg against it. Just make sure I'm aware of it at a depiction of the product in your attachment, you should be okay.
Thank you, Ian. Thanks You're for welcome. Sitting in the hot seat.
Yep.
And I do want to thank Stephanie Fields and Tracy Torres too, who were behind the scenes answering the questions for everybody as Ian provided the presentation. It definitely takes a team here, so I appreciate all of you. And again, thank you to everybody that called in. We hope to see you all in 2 weeks. And yes, with that, I think we will call it a wrap. So thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Bye, all.
See ya.
Visit TTB's official YouTube channel at usttb.gov for more TTB-related content. And remember to click subscribe so you'll always know when we upload new videos.